How do you accomplish that? Because, I mean, there's only so much time in the day. You probably have an amazing team, and there's got to be.
The key word is team and delegation and surrounding yourself with people who are better than you, essentially. So, I mean, that's really what it all comes down to. I think anybody that's successful will probably tell you the same thing, that you might be good at one thing, but you need to be good at 20 things. So figure out what you're good at and then attract people by luck or design that are better than you, essentially. So precious about everything, that you think that you can do everything better than anybody else. You see you listen to the radio, see your billboard, then you come home and then there's a TV commercial. The TV commercial might be the right hook, or it might be any of those combination, or they just keep hearing blah, 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 Gary Ashton, blah, 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 Gary Ashton, blah, blah, blah. And then you go online, search for something, and then there's Gary Ashton again. So they all work together, and it's really hard to track which is the right hook, but it's a combination of all those things, essentially.
So welcome to the Top Real Estate Influencers Podcast. We're here today with Mario Hurley, Alex Montalenti, and special guest Gary Ashton. I wanted to bring Gary on because he's really just doing it all. Everything we preach about, everything we talk about, to newbie agents, to top producers, to brokers, to brokerages, all of that. I see your group everywhere. I know that you're a powerhouse, you're a force to be reckoned with. You've got a huge team behind you. I love what you just shared earlier with us. So we're happy to have you on the show.
Yeah, happy to be here. Nice to meet you all.
Yeah, well, welcome, Gary. I said I wanted to introduce a little bit about who we are, since we're literally getting to know each other during this podcast.
Yeah.
We have a similar vision or approach as what I've observed about you, which is we also want to go reach everyone, and we want to harness technology. And at the end of the day, we want to provide value so people love us and they bring us more people. And so we grow organically.
I mean, it's just the cliche, right? That you want to do the best possible service for your clients so that they come out as raving fans when they've been through the real estate transaction. And also you want to make sure that they're constantly aware of you, so you don't do a good job and then forget about them, or they forget about you. You want to constantly be in front of them, and that might be through email drip campaigns, or it might be through retargeting through all the different web forms, which I don't know how that's going to change soon, but the one thing that you can't get around is seeing billboards when you drive around. So that reinforces what we do on radio and TV, and TV and radio work together, and the billboards reinforce, and it all comes. If you listen to Gary V,
oh, we do.
Gary Vaynerchuk, that will be the jab, 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 right hook. You know, where does the right hook come from? Well, for me, it's the sports marketing that we do with the Tennessee Titans, that's the NFL team, or the Nashville Predators, that's the NHL team, or it might be the billboards that you see around town, might be the radio that you listen to when you're driving around, and then you see a billboard, or you listen to the radio, see a billboard, then you come home and then there's a TV commercial. The TV commercial might be the right hook, or it might be any of those combination, or they just keep hearing blah, 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 Gary Ashton, blah, 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 Gary Ashton, blah, blah, blah. And then you go online, search for something, and then there's Gary Ashton again. So they all work together, and it's really hard to track which is the right hook, but it's a combination of all those things, essentially. So yeah, that's the old school and the new school.
Yeah, I love that. And you know what? I also learned, me and you have something in common. I am also a drummer.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. It's funny how many drummers I've got on the team. I think we have like four or five drummers. And I remember I was at a conference one time and I said, I'm probably better than anybody in the audience at drumming, because I was being a little arrogant.
Sure.
But then I got these messages from people afterwards saying, hey, I'm actually a pretty good drummer, because I played at a decent level and I used to think I was pretty good until I came to Nashville. And that's when I realized I'm good, but people here are amazing, like so talented. That became the end of my drumming career when I moved to Nashville, basically.
Are you kidding? You stopped playing?
Well, I know I still play, but I realized that I wasn't going to make any money or make it to the level that I needed to be earning, because there's 18-year-old kids who are just absolutely phenomenal, like brilliant, amazing. I mean, usually I can listen to somebody and figure out what they're doing, but sometimes you'll get somebody that's doing some Afro-Cuban polyrhythms and stuff, and you go, how the heck is he doing that?
Yes.
You don't get that much in country, but every now and again, you see people playing the street in Nashville called Broadway, which is where all the honky-tonks are, and you can see guys there that are so good. They're essentially in a Ferrari driving around at 15 miles per hour, and then they'll get it up to 50, and then they'll every now and again they'll get up to 75 and 100, and it's probably over the head of most of the members in the audience. They know is a really good drummer, but some of the stuff that they do, you'd like, good grief, that's amazing. So yeah, I when I moved here, that was the plan. I was going to do all this music and a little bit of real estate, and then I suddenly realized that's not going to work. I'm going to have to do a lot of real estate and do some music. So yeah, I don't play professionally. I've got a lot of friends that are involved in the music business, because I mean, you're in Nashville, so you can't help but be friends with people in the music business. But I haven't played. So I will tell you one story. I went to one of my friends is a recording engineer, like a really good record engineer, Jordan Ribby, and he was playing at Ocean Way, recording at Ocean Way Studios, and I'd never been. So I said, come on, I want to come in and see it, because it's kind of a famous studio. So he said, yeah, come on down. And then there was a drum kit set up in the studio. So I said, oh, let me play just so I can say I've played at Ocean Way. And I hadn't played a real kit for a while. And that's when I realized that, good grief, I'm not anywhere as good as I used to be. Cause it was like getting on, and all of a sudden your brain has the messages sending to your muscles, but your muscles are going, whoa, hey, what's up? We haven't done this for 2-3 years. Can't we just get right back into it? So yeah, I realized, if you don't keep on practicing, because when I was playing, I was probably practicing 2-3 hours a day, just driving around or getting or playing. And once you get away from that, then all of a sudden you lose all that muscle memory, as it were.
That's right. Yeah. So a little bit about your background, Alex.
Sorry, I gotta add one thing. I'll never forget. So Mario loves to just jump on the drum. So we did we were in Orlando for a real estate trade show, and we had the team with us. And Mario is walking down the street, sees this guy with, is playing the drums on like a bunch of buckets and stuff like that, like makeshift drums. And he just hops on. He like gave the guy, like 10 bucks or something. He's like, hey, let me play your buckets. Jumps on, starts playing the buckets. Then one of my sales team members, he starts rapping. And then the other guy starts singing. And now the three of them are just on a street corner in downtown Orlando, just jamming.
And you were just dancing? You were
I was the guy on video catching them. And I was like, I have to show
them. I mean, Mario, you must be good, because I wouldn't have the confidence to go jump on one of those buckets. I've never played them, but those guys are pretty good too. There's a lot of talented people in the world. So
I learned from the bassist from Casey and the Sunshine Band, who also used to play drums. Yep. One of the things he taught me was to play as hard as I can. That was what he taught me. And I never forgot that. So I had these thick drumsticks. I even forgot the number, the code of the drumsticks. So when I played those buckets on the street, I actually broke his buckets. I was like, see, that's how you do it.
And then you walked away, like dropping the mic.
That's right. I paid my 10 bucks. He was happy.
Money for a new bucket. That's terrible.
Exactly. But I wanted to ask you, what I gather from your work, and you've shared your story is amazing, because you started in England.
Yep.
But you came from an entrepreneurial family already. Entrepreneurial family.
Yes. I mean, the first thing I did, I don't know if you've read this, but we had a mom and pop motel, what you guys would we call them bed and breakfast.
Bed and breakfast, right.
Mom and pop motel. So that was me and my dad. My dad really, dad was an accountant and then got made redundant and then decided he never wanted to be made redundant again. So we ended up buying these mom and pop motels, which we did together. I bought wine, imported wine. That was my first entrepreneurial adventure. Went to France and Germany and we brought wine back in a container. And then I was trying to sell that. This is in 96, 95, something like a long time ago. So wine wasn't even, wine was a bit of a rarity in England at that time.
Oh, wow.
The only wine that people knew was a wine called Blue Nun, and that was about it, a leap from us. So I went to Germany and yeah, we bought a container full of wine, and it took me a long time to sell it. But that was my first venture on my own.
How old are you?
So how old is I then?
Yeah.
20 something, 20.
Oh, there you go.
21, 22, straight out of college. Essentially. Wow. Might be 23. Can't remember. Honestly, really can't remember that. That shows you're getting old when you can't remember all the stuff that you did in the past.
Alex, you started your entrepreneurial adventure also when you were young, selling bottles.
No, collecting cans in the trains. I would collect like 20 to. I was a young child model. My mom would take me to the city for modeling gigs. And when I was on the train, I picked up a can and I'm like, Mom, what's this? It says 5 cents something. She's like, yeah, you can take them to the pizza place and get 5 cents. I'm like, are you serious? Why are people leaving money all over the floor? So I would bring huge garbage bags with me when I go to the city with my mom on the train ride in. I'd go under all the seats, grab all the cans, put them in a bag, go to the pizza place. And I'm like, I want my money.
Smart. Yeah.
But I was thinking, why wouldn't you be making a lot of money already from your modeling?
Yeah, I didn't get that. But I got some of the money, but I mean, I didn't get that mentally. I was like, no, this is money right now. That's money. It's a check. When am I going to see that?
Yeah.
You know, you put a
cash
dollar.
Flow. It's all about right cash flow, now. Mario.
Yeah.
All about cash flow. Okay. All right. So let's do a little bit of a fast forward to like current times.
Yeah.
I know you know about search engine optimization. Yeah. You did your Google ads.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you do Facebook ads?
I do. I just starting using, well, I've always done some stuff independently. I kind of know about retargeting and custom audiences and things like that. So doing it in various forms, but we just started using Whitley actually.
Whitley. Okay.
Yeah. Because that makes it simple. The Facebook, the back end of Facebook, the app, it's forever changing. And just when you kind of get to know it a little bit, then they change it and then they change it. But we do retargeting through Wailopo for Facebook ads and things like that. And like I said, we just started using Whitley for some really targeted stuff. Like I said, I know enough about it to be dangerous, but yeah, we're doing Facebook ads. Have been doing for a while, but that's all changing. That was the one thing I was saying earlier on, is like that whole, the Facebook pixel and all that good stuff and the phones and the way that Apple's changing the landscape on that. It's who knows what's going to happen. Every time they do somebody will come up with some way of getting around that usually. But yeah, it's going to be interesting in the next few months, next year or so.
Are you on the TikTok yet?
I'm on TikTok, but that's one thing that I don't really do. I mean, I have an account. I think I've got 5 posts on there. You know, I was just at Inman, and then the number of people that are doing really, really well with Inman, just creating content. Because I think TikTok originally, I think, used to be all about dancing girls and people doing stupid things. But then I actually realized that it can be very educational, because I like everybody else, you go through TikTok and then you're lost for 5 hours because you keep scrolling through stuff. But I don't know if you've seen the guys that give you tips on iPhones, another tip on iPhone that you didn't know about. Then there's somebody else will send me something and go, here's a really good cooking tip. And next thing you know, the algorithm starts changing because now you're looking at different things and then it serves you up more of those things. And I've seen some crazy stuff on there, but seen some really interesting and useful stuff. But am I using it to generate leads? No, I should be. If I'm involved in social media, it's mainly Instagram. I run my Instagram account. We have a brokerage Instagram account, and I'll do stuff on there. And then I post that to Facebook. So
yeah, the only reason I brought it up is because I saw a video that just went on Facebook that you were in that was like welcome to Nashville. It was these two guys.
So the welcome to Nashville thing was awesome.
That thing can go viral.
Oh yeah. So they did one 5 years ago and it was excellent. It was really good. And then they're two local guys. So eventually you get to meet people at events and things like that. And so I met them, got on great with them. And then they did a second one, which wasn't as good, but the one they just did. So now they have an actual media production company. So I think they kind of went all out on this one and asked me, they called up and said, hey, we got a line about billboards. Do you want to be in it? And I said, well, what's the line? I wasn't really sure, but it was just making fun. So it was kind of, I knew it was going to be a little poking fun at me in some shape or form or very self-effacing. And it turned out to be pretty cool. So, that was my idea was to pop up, come from the ground. So I did that. So they put me down as a special appearance. It's a great video. If you Google it, welcome to Nashville, you'll see it. It's super, about 5 minutes long.
Super catchy tune.
Yeah, so that's the thing about it. You can come up with that idea. Yeah, we're going to go around different neighborhoods and we're going to have all the restaurants and we're going to kind of make fun of all the people that come into Nashville, bachelorettes and stuff like that.
Gary's just featured as like the man in Nashville. Like,
yeah, he talks about Derrick Henry. He's about coming up from recovering from COVID like a stiff arm from Henry and then rise up like all the billboards from Gary. So I thought that was because they told me the lyrics before they did it. I said, no, that sounds good. So we did it.
That thing on TikTok, through the roof.
Yeah, somehow you got to get it on there. I don't know. Somebody's got to post it. I sent it to quite a few friends and they liked it because the quality. Oh, that's what we were talking about. The quality of the recording is really, really good. I mean, there's kind of like no expense spared compared to the first ones that they did. But the song is really good. It's a catchy song and it's well recorded. So Ken, I got a friend here. Hang on, let me show you. Little Stanley.
Hey, he's there.
Trying to get me to play with him. But yeah, it was a good video. And I sent that out to quite a few people, just friends, and they've loved it. And if you live in Nashville or you've visited Nashville, you can relate to it because there's certain things about it that are kind of funny but also brutally honest and true. So there's some stuff about the traffic being bad and we're full, but we still say welcome to Nashville. And it's good video.
Yeah.
But yes, you're right. We need to get it on TikTok or they need to get it on TikTok, which would be cool. But it's 5 minutes long. How long are the things on TikTok? Like with Instagram, you can do the IGTV so you can get the full thing. But I don't know about TikTok. Alex, you need to take that on.
Yeah, it has to be a shortened version, but I mean, we definitely want to get the line with you in it,
Yes. I do have a little clip that somebody sent me with just me just popping up. I should put that on. Yeah.
Yeah, we just had a call with Peter Hernandez, who's president of the West Coast of Douglas Elliman, and we're doing a TikTok. I'm Mario challenged me and him to go head to head on a TikTok challenge. So
okay.
Within the next 2 weeks, we're each doing 10 TikTok videos.
So I need to follow you on TikTok to see that then, right?
Yeah, follow. I'm going to do it on the Real Grader page. So it's
cool.
Follow Peter.
I've got people texting me left around. So we've got all the stuff with Zillow going on. So people keep texting me, asking me what's going on.
So for the TikTok, I mean, if you want to join our challenge, Gary, that'll be fun.
No. What am I going to do?
The challenge is
be like dancing.
Five TikToks per day, but following all the TikToks
per day.
TikToks per week.
Okay. Yeah, five a day is going to be a little bit of a stretch there.
Okay, but here I'm actually giving these gentlemen the specific techniques on how to post so that you actually get the most amount of views and you go viral. Cool.
So what's the content? Is it you just have to come up with something about real estate, or is it just something funny, or what's the deal on that?
Well, to answer your question, TikTok has all these specific things that it watches, the dances, the songs, the hashtags, the specific things. So what I did is I made a list of all of these items and actions that TikTok is watching. So I said, do one of these per day.
Okay. That's so it. Where would you find this?
We can send it to you.
TikTok, there's one of my clients, Bobby Bones. I'll look at that later. See, you never know what's going to happen on TikTok when you open it up.
Right.
That was cool.
So far, it's the most addicting app, I would say.
It is, because I don't wake up and look at TikTok. I mean, I usually wake up and check my text messages. Then I do go to Instagram, I will admit.
There you go.
If I went to TikTok, and then I would probably still be in bed, you know, because it is, once you start, So I don't really watch TV anymore. I got rid of cable. I have Hulu, so I do can watch TV, but I generally watch YouTube. So YouTube has the same kind of algorithm, because I like music documentaries, you know, like stuff like behind the scenes of in the recording studios. There's a guy called Rick Beato, and he breaks down, you know, what makes this song great, and he goes down and if you're a musician or just somebody that likes music, you'd find it really interesting, because he'll bring out the drums, just hear how the drums are recorded, and then put the bass in and see how they work together, and then put in the different guitars and then the melody on top and see how everything works. And if you know, it's really cool. So I like that, and I like World War II documentaries. I like that kind of stuff. I like travel. So YouTube knows that. So that it keeps serving me up. What about this video, Gary? And I'm like, oh, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, but that looks awesome. Next thing you know, it's 4 o'clock in the morning and you're waking up and you've still got YouTube playing in your bedroom.
That's the second thing I have in common with you. I'm the same way. I like to go as deep as possible. Show me more. Like where it all started, like the Beatles, you name it. I want to know.
Yeah, you should watch Rick Beato. He's got some really, it's spelled Beato, B-E-A-T-O. Uh-huh. But he says his name is Rick Beato. So I was calling it Rick Beato for a long time, but it's Rick Beato. And really, really interesting channel for music. And he'll break down the top 10 songs in Spotify.
Oh, wow.
And show you what the chord progressions are and look at historical stuff and show you some of the most, the hardest songs in the world to play and things like that. But also, like I said, he'll break down. He just had an interview with Brian May from Queen. That was really interesting, you know, like Bohemian Rhapsody and breaking that down and how they recorded it. So Brian May's done those interviews numerous times about Bohemian Rhapsody, but because Rick is an actual musician, I mean, he's a really talented, if you watch him, he can play, one of those guys that can play anything, but really good on guitar and good on piano. And so he was asking really good questions of Brian May that a normal interview probably in terms of being musical. So that's what Brian was like, oh, that's a great question. Let me think about how did we do that? So it was great to get to see that. You should watch it. Really good. Really good show.
I already wrote it down.
Oh, cool.
Let's go back to
real estate.
Yeah. Yeah, no, real estate marketing and technology. That's what we were excited about. You know, in one of your podcasts, you mentioned a woman named Sarah Cocky.
Sarah Cocky, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's up and, in, where is it? It's in Canada. It's a frozen, what town is she in? Can't remember. But yes, just outside Calgary, 2 hours from Calgary. It'll come back to me in a minute. But
well, the reason why I thought that was super interesting is because you mentioned how you're doing so much, mm-hmm. right? And you have this, what do you call that? You have this.
I said I was on a tanker or an ocean liner, and then maybe Sarah's a smaller agent, so she's not. She's more like a little speedboat. She can zip around, stop and change. And
she's super efficient, though, and she's still a top producer.
Correct. So, she's just by herself. I think she's got 2 or 3 assistants. She has her own photographer going doing stuff. Whereas I've got 185 agents and 60 staff. So it's the momentum for us is great because we keep going like this, keep going forward, and we keep getting bigger and attracting more agents and attracting more technology and ways of actually working with the consumer. And like we said before, it's a bit of a cliche, but we're always trying to figure out what's the best way to make our clients happy, essentially. So
is that limited to just Nashville?
I'm just in Nashville, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What are your goals or what's like your vision long term?
I think that I don't have a massive vision for growth, but sometimes opportunities are handed to you and it's like, oh, that's too good to turn down. So I think we may have some stuff bubbling under maybe, but I don't, I got another friend of mine, Chris Lindell, who's up in Minneapolis. Chris is really on an expansion plan and he's got the systems in place to be able to do that. I think he's going in. So he's in Minneapolis and then he's going into Wisconsin. He's going into different markets. That's not really, he's younger than me as well, so that's not really my focus, but I've got people on that work with me, Deborah Beagle and Scott Hull and Johnny Lee, and they're looking at different opportunities we've got. So, and as we network more and more with people, those opportunities keep presenting themselves. So
kind of like the definition for luck when opportunity meets preparation.
Yeah. Yeah. So I always say that, I mean, you probably heard me say it before, people ask, how did you get to where you are? And I just put it down to luck. I always say it's luck, vision, and money. You've got to have some luck, but you've got to have some vision to be able to act on the luck. And then you need some money to be able to apply that to your vision and your luck. And then it's like the combination of all those three. Is it all money? Maybe. Is it all luck? Maybe. But is it all vision? But usually it's a combination of all three. So yeah, it's luck is, what was it? Some of the preparation and opportunity meets preparation, was it?
I don't know. Yeah, luck is the definition of luck is when opportunity meets preparation.
I like that. I've heard that before. Mm-hmm. Luck, vision, and money, though. Nobody says that apart from me.
There you go.
Okay, cool.
And what about your philosophy? Because you have, like you said, it's kind of like an old school. You said you have this philosophy that you want to make sure your employees are employed, like you keep on taking care of them, as opposed to saying that it's just only about number one.
Yeah, I mean, that's like having a bunch of kids, right? You, if you have one kid, then you have two, then you have three. Well, then you're going to make sure that they have a good education and they're looked after. And so that means that you have to go out and work. And then now you have to work a little harder because now you've got another mouth to feed. Again, it's like that whole cliche. But yes, I think when you get to the size of 180 agents, and I mean, we're just a brokerage that operates as a team and a team that's a brokerage. So, but when you get to that point, it's not just me and three agents, which is how I started, or two agents. Now you've got all these other people that are coming in with good ideas, and then you know that you have to do something to keep pushing the bar forward, and you want to keep staying ahead of everybody. So That's what I like. I like the new shiny objects, and this is why I go to conferences and Inman and Network and the NAR conferences and things like that, because you always meet somebody that's got a cool new idea. And then this is where being, because we're the number one Remax team in the world, that means that I get to meet people and get introductions that maybe I wouldn't have if I was just a single agent or a two-person team. Because some of those developers and the tech, they want somebody that's going to be able to either beta test their product or use it and then become use this as a platform to show how successful it was because we're using it. And so everything that we use usually pans out. So and that, like I said, it's really all about staying ahead of the curve with what's available for everybody else. You want to be the first one to talk about how can you start, you know, reevaluate. I used them 2018. I didn't think it was very good, so we stopped. And yeah. Now they've, what, be like 5 years later, now the product's really good, so we started using them again. So I'm sure you'll start seeing the fact that we're using Revaluate because they want to use us as a poster boy for it, as it were. But it is, yeah. I've seen it, the scores that they're coming up with, it's really now enabling us to contact people because they're you're mining your existing database. So, and when you get to our size, when we've got, I don't know, 200 and something thousand people in the database, you've got to have something. They either call you and say, hey, I want to sell my house, or I'm thinking about selling my house. So they call you, but then if you have something that gives you the ability to say, hey, I see you might be thinking about making a move, because they have all these predictive analytics that are essentially, you know, scoring them. And when it gets to a certain point, we get a notification, say, hey, call Alex, looks like he's getting ready to move. So that's been really good. I forgot why I was talking about that. Yeah.
I got a question for you.
Yeah.
This is something I deal with, and I'm sure you dealt with it or you run into it.
Mm-hmm.
I have clients that know me for 21 years, right? They're like, Alex Montalenti.
I still go to Zillow to look at homes.
What's that?
And they then go to Zillow to look at a home and then get connected with a realtor that way.
Well, yeah, no? But where I'm going with it is they're always coming to me.
Yep.
And I have a team of 25 people, like technology experts, marketing experts.
Yep.
They're like, yeah, but Alex, I get that you got a great team, but I want you, Alex. I know you. I want you. I don't care how much you charge, whatever. I want you. I don't want them.
Yeah. Right? Well, then you need to get people that are smarter and more talented than you. And then it becomes patently obvious, because I will say, sure, we can go look at homes. Alex is in the trenches every day. He knows the market. He's fairly really aware. He's going to know about all the off-market properties too. So, yeah, I could come along, but really, Alex is going to be the guy that's going to really help you with it. And I'll say, I haven't written a contract since 2007 or something like that. So they want to do that, but they realize, I think you just have to be honest and say, you know, I'm not as good as I once was when it comes to knowing what's really going on, like I said, in the trenches. And if you're out there every day selling, and then I haven't been out there. I mean, I did show a home yesterday, but I'm not out there like the agents who, they're the ones that are on getting the knowledge and going in and physically seeing the properties. And this is where, this is the value of the agent, because it's not just pictures and numbers. You need somebody that has been to that community, has actually looked at the house, knows the one thing that you can't get across when you're looking at even virtual tours or videos, you know, what's that ambient feel? How do you describe it? You need somebody that's been out there and can talk to you. Or when we're looking, you know, walking through a house with you, they start to get a feel for what you're looking for. So that's that personal interaction, which is which is what will keep the realtors around, that local knowledge and knowing that this house is perfect for you, but it's going to be, you're looking at an hour commute, and then, you know, where you're working, are you happy with an hour commute? And some people will say yes, but most people really, especially in the Nashville area, probably want to be more in the 15 to 30 minutes. So it's just having that knowledge. So if they ask for me, yeah, they can talk to me. And if they're my close friends, I would still say the same thing, you know, like Mario, he's the expert on Franklin, or Alex is the expert on Brentwood. So you'd be much better off with those guys. And, you know, I might come out one time and I had a friend that referred another friend from Minneapolis. So they came down and they, kind of like you said, they wanted to work with me, but I brought one of my agents along, and they, you can hear how the conversation goes, because it becomes pretty apparent that my agent knew way more than me about that market. And so then it's kind of like a handoff, like when we work with the Titans or the Preds, the same thing, you know, we got people.
I think that's the letting go part, you know, is huge. I mean, I did the same thing. I'm like, I'm not organized. You don't want to work with me. Like my team is amazing. They do this stuff all the time. I don't do this stuff all the time.
Yeah. And you can still go out there and help. And you obviously know about real estate, and because you're not where you are without having been good at it, but to actually go and see every single home, and you're better off just almost in a way, like you say, deferring to somebody who knows, who's got a better, more recent knowledge of the market.
Plus, if you're gonna go, if you're gonna go and, you know, go show every house to everyone that wants to work only with you, you're not gonna have time to enjoy your TikTok and your YouTube.
100%. So Mario, spot on there. Straight to the point. Very prestigious. Yeah. So and I have found that when I've gone out with people, if you ask me at the end of the day, what have I done? I said, I can't always remember, but I know that when I go out with people, then all of a sudden I've got all this stuff that I should have been doing is being put on the back burner. And it does mess up your day with all the other stuff that you're doing.
There you go. Exactly. And Alex, you've run into that.
Oh yeah, for sure.
We're actually right now, you know what we're working on, Gary? We're actually working on making our coaches / mm-hmm. salespeople / mm-hmm. presenters mm-hmm. become so good at what they do that yep. they can talk to 500 people on Zoom without having to travel to every state, every city in the country, and yep. make five times above industry average in sales.
Wow. Just through coaching?
That's right. Daily coaching. Daily polishing.
Are you guys doing lead generation too? Or just coaching on sales techniques?
The biggest thing we do is we set up realtors for success online.
Yeah. Yep.
So we optimize them on Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, YouTube, homes.com, realtor.com, Zillow, any site that would matter for a realtor.
Yeah.
And like today we did a webinar. It was amazing to watch one of our presenters, Michael. He was a Zoom just like this, right? Like, yep. But instead of Mario and Alex, it was an entire office of 30 agents and another office in another region of another 30 agents. Yep. And he's just commanding the room and working with them and like interacting.
So were you guys doing that before COVID came about? Yeah, because we were doing literally, what was the... There's a program called, it was this, but it was the early versions of it. So we were doing that online classes a long time ago, maybe 10, 12, go-to meeting, I think it was called. Yeah, go-to
right,
meeting.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
Which is the same thing as this, right, essentially?
Yeah, it is.
So we were doing that a long time ago. So I feel like we were ahead of the curve, but to get a client to come to a go-to meeting, they're like, whoa, no, I'm not doing it. I got to download this. No. Just come and see us. So with COVID, it was great because it essentially compressed about the next 5 years into 3 or 4 months where people saw the value in being able to hold meetings like this. And now, instead of me coming over to present an offer, because they'd be like, oh no, Gary's coming over with an offer. He's going to want a coffee. He wants his cookies. We're going to have a small talk about the Titans and the Predators. Then he's going to want to talk about his dogs for 20 minutes. And then he'll get to the whole business of presenting the offer. But now they realize, well, we can just do it online. So now if I said, hey, I'll be over at 7. I like to present the offer. We got a great offer. I'll talk you through it. Can we just do a Zoom? And so that become part of the everyday conversation and vernacular that people understand the concept of a Zoom. And then really that saves me a 20-minute drive out to your place. And then an hour at your house being, well, I think I'm being social by asking for a coffee and chatting, telling you about my kids. And you really just want me to present the offer. But then that takes 15 minutes now on the Zoom. And then we can go through, I can share my screen, go through all the different points in the contract that are relevant. We can write the counter offer or accept it and send it over. You e-sign it and everybody's happy. So, and then people started using that for doing meetings with their families, you know, and it just became the way to socialize during the lockdown. But, you know, I think people just, the technology keeps changing and you have to be open to and be forward thinking to adapt and change with it. Because if you ever see somebody walking down the street doing this and they're kind of looking at the phone, well, you know now that they're just doing a FaceTime with somebody, but, you know, 6-7 years ago, you'd be like, what? No, that guy's crazy. He's talking to his phone. So it just, people's, what they find acceptable, it changes. And COVID, like I said, it brought forward the future and people willing to accept and adapt to new technology that much quicker. Because really, it's just like you went from a horse-drawn cart to a, what's this thing in the front? An engine? That's crazy. That's terrible. But, you know, 10 years later, there were Model T Fords running around everywhere. And then now look at us where we are.
That was our biggest challenge. We used to do presentations in person. We used to take donuts, sandwiches. And sometimes we would end up with two full trays of donuts that nobody ate because nobody showed up. Yeah. Now we don't have to spend money on travel, donuts or sandwiches or anything.
Right.
We catch them while they're driving, some of them.
Yeah, it's much more convenient for everybody. Everybody.
And yeah,
So Mario, where are you based?
Right now, South Beach.
South Beach. Alex, where are you based?
I'm in Miami Beach, but the office is in Midtown, Miami.
Yeah, so I'm in Nashville. So look at this. We're having this conversation. There's no time lag. I feel like I'm sat here looking at a computer screen, but really we're all in the virtual little room. You know, that's kind of what EXP does with those meetings. They're all virtual meetings. So the world is a changing place and you just have to be willing to adapt and change. And obviously there's going to be people that won't. And those are the ones that become the dinosaurs and then, you know, retire or go off to do something else because they don't want to be part of the new world. But
are you experiencing any kind of resistance from your team? People saying, oh, that techie stuff, that social media stuff, I don't want to do that.
No. I think without being too arrogant, I think in Nashville, people know that we're a techie team. We're forward, you know, we're fast moving. And once you've learned something, then Gary will come back and go, oh, we got something new for you now. And then they're like, half of them go, ah, but they realize that's pretty cool. That's going to be awesome. So you don't you don't get into one system and then that's it, you're done. It's constantly evolving and changing. So that obviously has some challenges, just because when you get into the rhythm of things, like we come in and go, oh, we got a new product now. Now you have to adapt to that. But then you go, oh, well, actually, this is cool. This is going to help me with CMAs, or it's going to help me with this, that, or the other. So no, we've not had that with any of the agents. We have a pretty strenuous boot camp. I think it's 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks long now. So if people come to that, we hopefully have we use a program called Echovate, actually, which is good for personality profiling. And that really helps with us making sure that, you know, we got profiles of our top producers, all the way through the brokerage for employees. And that helps us then, if when Alex signs up, we can put him through the process. You know, you got to do an interview prior to getting into the main interview. You got to do the go through, answer all the questions. And that helps us then look at that and go, okay, Alex is really strong here. From his answers, we can see this is going to be a challenge here, but he's so good here. Let's figure out how we can approach the way that we talk to Alex so that we can support him on. Now, you told me earlier on, Alex, you're not very good with paperwork. So that's a typical profile of somebody who's really good at sales, great with the clients, great with the customers, awesome, terrible with paperwork. So yeah, now we can make sure that we support Alex, but we also are aware that Alex is bad with paperwork, because we do that anyway. We have contract to close for all the agents. But some people have that. They think they can do it all, but we have to prove to them, look how much more efficient is Alex. If you hand that off to your contract to close, Michelle's going to do an amazing job with this. It's going to make you look more professional now, because you can essentially say, I'm going to have my assistant, we'll get the information from the home inspection, get you all the information about the need for the utilities and things like that. So now we can really help Alex, and Alex will realize, you know what, that's cool. Now I can go out and show homes and help another client, and now I'm going to be that much more efficient and pass that back off to my contract to close. And then it could be the other way. You got somebody that's amazing, that's attention to detail is fantastic, but maybe they're not good with the sales pitch or asking the right questions. So now we know, well, that's something Mario, we need to start coaching Mario, because he's not he's great with people, but he's not good at asking to the point of knowing, is this a home that you want to write an offer on? You know, all that good stuff. And
that's brilliant.
So that's been really good for us. So
it's called Echo, you said?
Echovate. It's Echovate. Yeah, it's really cool. I was going to say something else. It just went out of my head. I blame you, Mario. That was terrible.
I know.
It's going to be like, wow, that's cool. We never thought of that. Oh, so I actually know what it was. Is that if you make it through to get to the boot camp, you will find out very quickly, because sometimes we have people that just go, this is a lot and I don't think I can do it. And so we can either say, come on, you just need to coach them through it. And they go, then they're really happy that you push them a little bit, or we've mutually come to the conclusion that you're a great, you'll be a good realtor, Mario, but probably not in this environment. You're not a good fit.
Mario calls that sifting.
Oh, so, yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's no point having somebody that can't adapt and change and work with your systems, because they'll just become frustrated. You'll become frustrated because now you're giving them valuable leads or opportunities, I think we like to call them. And then if you keep dropping the ball, because for whatever reason, it's better to figure that out early on in the process rather than 6 months later or 7 months later. Look at the opportunities that we've given you. Look at, you've wasted this, you've done that. and it becomes a bit of a confrontational relationship because you're like, come on, why haven't you done this? So
yeah.
Again,
like a cultural fit
too. Yeah, and so
they either fit into your culture or they don't.
Yeah, so you know, we coach with John Chetlak, and then you'll say, no, the problem's not the agent. You got to look at yourself, and you have to start approaching things slightly differently. And so asking the question, you know, Alex, so what could we have done differently to help you out here? Because it looks like you're having a little problem. Is it something that we've done? Was there anything we can do to help you? So you approach it from a completely different perspective. And yeah, I've forgotten what your original question was, but yes.
No problem. I want to ask you one last question before we go. What's coming up next, like this year? Any upcoming tech conferences, anything big that you're excited about before the end of the year?
I'm going to NAR in December the 12th, I think. 12th, 13th, 15th, I think. 12th, yeah, that weekend.
I'll be there.
So that's going to be cool because HomeSnap were acquired by CoStar. So CoStar is owned by Florence. Yeah, Andy Florence. Yeah. I think it's Florence. And then they bought apartments.com. And just recently they just bought homes.com. So Andy was speaking at Inman with Brad, you know, had one of those like interviews. And what he was saying, he was trying to bring back the power of the listing to the listing agent. So, because I think now when somebody goes looks online, even my site, you're making inquiries, but definitely on Zillow, realtor.com, the public's getting connected with a realtor that's going to give them the information, but a lot of times they think they're talking to the listing agent. So the way that homes.com, the way that Andy was talking about it, is that they're going to put the power back in the hands of the actual listing agent. So when somebody calls, they'll get connected directly with the listing agent. So not sure how that's going to play out in the long run, but that's something I guess they're going to be revealing in San Diego. That's going to be a big push from homes.com. So that's going to be really cool. You know, Zillow just backed out of the whole iBuying process, which is interesting. Still don't quite know the reasoning behind that. I mean, they've said it was because of overcapacity, couldn't get the staff in. There was problems with supply chain, things like that. So I think, interestingly enough, the public was really catching on to the concept of selling your house to essentially a third party, like a Zillow, Open Door, Offerpad, and then not having to do any showings and not have to do, you could set your closing date. So it became really convenient. And I think people were happy to take a market value, not put it out there and see if they could get another 5,000 or another 10,000. They were just happy with going, okay, peace of mind. I've sold my house. I didn't have to do any repairs. I didn't have to keep my house clean for 2 weeks while people were coming through. I know exactly when it's going to close. So this makes it really convenient for the seller. So that whole concept of the iBuyer, I think it's catching on. So now Open Door just got that $9 billion capital injection. So they're going to be big players in the market. So I don't think it's going away. It's just, it was interesting that Zillow paused. They told us they were pausing. And then they pulled out. So that's going to be interesting. So we see, I think EXP has their own iBuying platform. I know that Redfin does. We have our own like in-house version of doing that. You got the people like Ribbon, you got people like Homewood. So it's interesting how technology is becoming more and more involved in the real estate process, because it becomes it's a multiplier for all these different verticals or all the peripheral services that come with it. So it's not just the actual real estate transaction, it's everything that's involved with real estate. So that means there's a whole trickle down to painters, to carpeting, to putting a new fridge in, having an electrician come in. And then, you know, when somebody buys a house, what's the first thing they do? If it's not a new construction, they're probably going to go out and want to make some cosmetic changes. They want to spruce up the yard. They want to paint the house. Then all that couch that they had in their old home, well, looks like we're going to need a new couch, because we've got this nice new house and we've got this old couch. So that's not, it doesn't fit. So it's a multiplier for so many other revenue streams for different businesses. So I think that the technology obviously has become aware of that. And so that's why you've got all these massive corporations now looking at getting involved. And then you've got all these people that are acquiring properties for property to rent. That's maybe it's changing the landscape of the American dream. Maybe now people don't have to buy a home to live in somewhere nice. They can now use the concept of cars, essentially, because I don't know if you own your own car or you lease a car, but lease a car, you'd always, I think in the past, people go, that's crazy, you're throwing away money.
Oh, but we're talking about 20, 30 years.
Car every 2 years. What's that?
I'm saying that concept of not leasing a car is like more like 20, 30 years ago, when that was a smart idea to buy a car. Nowadays, I don't know anybody that buys a car. Everyone is leasing.
Yeah, because you know that as long as you don't do 100,000 miles a year, you know, you got your window of this, that's where you're going to travel, and this is the miles you're going to do. And then you know that in 2 years' time, as long as you keep it, you're going to be able to turn it back in, and then you get another one. You're going to have to put some money
down. There's a price for convenience. There's a price for change it up. I love to change it up every 3 years and get something new. Car for 6 years. That's crazy.
I mean, what version of the iPhone do you have? Do you have the one that you got 4 years ago?
No way.
You keep trading in, and I mean, I always want the latest version, so I just got the new one. It's awesome.
Yeah.
So that NAR event, from my original question, that NAR event, is that in December?
No, that's the one.
November. November the... What's today?
We're gonna be there. We're gonna be there too. We have a booth there. We'll be there.
Oh, cool! I'll come over and see you. Yeah. So that's November 12th to the 15th. I think it is.
So we should do a follow up. Find out once we know what's going on, what they're planning to do. We should do a follow up.
Yeah, I'm really interested to see, because I know that Holmes is going to be making a big splash there. It's going to be take over the town.
I love that.
They just changed their logo on homes.com.
Oh, they did?
It looks like the CoStar logo a little bit.
Ah, yeah. So, yeah, I didn't really know much about CoStar, because we got a couple of guys on the team that do commercial real estate too, but they have a completely different approach, and obviously doing extremely well, you know, with Loop. I think it's LoopNet's theirs, right? That's their...
That's how I got in the business, actually. So my mom was doing residential real estate back in like the 80s and 90s. And then I came home from college. I started helping her a little bit.
Yeah.
Like when the internet first hit. And then she got this listing for a commercial piece of property. She had no idea about commercial. I started doing some internet marketing for her, email marketing. And a contact was like, hey, we got a buyer for that commercial property. Wow. And it was an $80,000 commission check for her, an $80,000 commission check for her business partner. They made $160,000 in commission. Yeah. And I was like, damn, a little bit of internet marketing. And you got she paid the mortgage for like years.
Yeah.
And she was a single mom paying the mortgage. So that's like,
well, that is an area that we're kind of, because of the authority of the site, if you Google Nashville commercial real estate, I think I'm number two and Luke is number one. So we do generate commercial real estate leads, opportunities. I always call them leads. I'm going to change the term. Yeah. It's opportunities. So, I think we'll probably get more and more involved in that because we've got good relationship with HomeSnap and now apartments.com and now homes.com. So I'm really curious about how we, because there's a, you know, obviously there's a perfect synergy between commercial real estate and residential real estate, because when somebody comes and brings in, like we dealt with the relocation of Hardee's hamburgers, which you may know as Carl's Jr. So it's one of those, it's the same company, but it was Hardee's in the north, east, south, and then on the west coast, it's Carl's Jr. But we dealt with the relocation of those employees coming from Carpinteria in just north of San Diego, actually. But they obviously, there's a synergy because they're all working with, they've got to find offices to put all those people. So we didn't actually get to work with the, that's probably a bad analogy because Carl's Jr. have their own real estate department because they're constantly buying new stores. So they already had somebody in place to do commercial real estate. But if it was, you know, we work with other companies where the headquarters to Nashville or Franklin or in the area. So they need to find homes for the executives and for the employees when they're bringing people in. So
it's totally relational. I'm standing here in Midtown right now.
Yeah.
It's like the commercial Target came first.
Yeah.
It was like this box and we were like, I'm not going to go to that Target. It's the middle of nowhere. And then now if you look around Midtown Miami, it's surrounded by the tallest condo buildings and there's like thousands and thousands of units. And it all started with like build that commercial line and then boom, residential pops up around it.
There you go. And so, you know, for us, we like if you were moving to Nashville and you were the CEO of some big, I'm not going to say printing company, but some company that you decided we're going to relocate the business to Nashville because there's no state income tax here and there's properties cheaper than it is in California or Miami or whatever, you know. So if I was working with you as a client, I could be helping you find a home. But then, when you meet somebody because you registered on our site and you start talking and you find a home and then you start chatting as you're driving around, then you find out that you're the CEO of so-and-so, this is why you're buying a $5 million house. And so I start talking to you more about, you know, what's bringing you to Nashville. And you go, yeah, we're bringing the company over. We got 75 employees in Miami. Maybe, I don't know how many are going to come with us, but there's probably going to be a minimum of 30 that are going to want to move. And then you go, oh, I can help you with those. And then, well, what are you looking for? Well, you know, we're looking for office space or we're looking. So then you can then go, wait, let me put you in touch with on my team. It's Ryan Turbeville, and Ryan is really knowledgeable in that area, in that space. So perfect synergy, you know, you make sure that you keep them within the same environment, but you making sure that the client gets the best possible service. So now it's, you got the real estate with the office acquisition or leasing, and then you've got the 75 employees that maybe, like I said, maybe 30, 40 of them are going to come to Nashville. So you want to try and pick those guys up as a relocation package.
Listen, if you take CoStar, mm-hmm. right, and you're looking at a commercial opportunity, and then you pair that with LinkedIn Sales Navigator to run an employee tree and organizational chart, boom, and now you retarget or market to those people.
Yep.
There you go.
And so a lot of times, you know, like when to go back to the Hardee's analogy, we knew before anybody else I should have known you then. We could have been smarter about retargeting. But when Andy Puzner, who's the CEO of Hardee's, he registered on my site with his real phone number, real address, contacted us. He was looking at, again, looking at, $3 or $4 million house that luckily went to one of my guys, Jeff Checo. So Jeff was the perfect guy to talk to Andy. So those two hit it off. And then Andy said, yeah, we're looking at maybe relocating Hardee's. CK, I think it's called CK something or other. That was the name of the company. That's the holding company for, anyway, so within 10, 15 minutes, we managed to connect them with the Economic Development Board, with the Chamber of Commerce, because we know people over there. And then, so we weren't just being a realtor. We were adding so much value. And that's, and then Andy made sure that his executives worked with Jeff, because Jeff did such an awesome job. And then that was the one piece that we, you know, we didn't get was the commercial, because like I said, they already had a commercial real estate division for buying and selling stores. But if they didn't, if it was another product, you know, we'd have been able to really tap into that too. So there's definitely a great synergy between commercial real estate and residential. So I'm really excited to see what happens with, yeah, with homes.com and the stuff that we're doing.
It may explode. I want to go ahead and say thank you so much, Gary, for joining us on our podcast. This was a really great conversation. Let's definitely have you back after this NAR conference.
Well, hopefully we'll see you out there.
Yeah, and I'll be there.
Alex will be there. We'll shake hands, take some selfies so we can brag a little
TikTok.
Bit.
We'll do a TikTok together.
Yeah, and then I think you meet a bunch of people out there, so it'll be good. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much for being with us. See you next time.
I enjoyed it. It was good fun.